I've created different branches as we move through different parts of this presentation, so you don't have to necessarily follow along and change the code as I go. It's all kind of bookmarked here. We'll start off on base images, which is the same as master right now, so either one of these is viable. Let's get started. So I've already installed it here. You know you have the base image if you have these two comments at the top. So this is where we're starting from. Okay, so as I just said, it's a ubiquitous platform. You're going to see it in any career path you choose that is, or any engineering path you choose that's going to use a cloud platform, you're going to run into Docker. There are some niche competition or competitors for Docker. They're usually platform chips that are paid to use, but because they're paid to use, they're a little more rare. So if you can understand Docker and you can utilize Docker, you're in a really good, in a good spot for most companies. The whole purpose of containers is to encapsulate your code and all your dependencies so that you can run anywhere without any setup. It goes from platform to platform and just works. So the software that I'm using in this demo, of course you need Docker. You know you have Docker if you have your little whale in your top corner. You need to be running in order to do that. This whole thing will be done in Node 8, so anything 8 or higher should be compatible. You're going to need NPM, and optionally you can use Yarn. Yarn's another new package, or another package manager. I use it because it tends to shave a couple seconds off the builds. It does things a little bit differently. And in some of the comparisons that I'll draw up, you can see the differences between NPM and Yarn in some cases. Again, the repo if you want to get the code there. So just some baseline Docker commands I'll be using. So to build a Docker image, you're going to use Docker build. To run an image to make sure that your image built correctly, this is the command I'll use to set a port, run it locally, and just test my image. And then if you want to just abandon, start over, something went wrong, you can system prune, and that will clear your system of all images and any dependencies you've established, and you can just start from scratch, which comes in handy sometimes when you're trying to troubleshoot. Okay, so let's start from where we are. Let me just run this locally. Yes.
When you say image, are you talking about
a
literal image or like image of your
cart? Image of, okay, great question. So an image, and this is what we were going to start. So an image is kind of like a baseline image to start from. Think of Linux. So if all you had was Linux and nothing else, just Linux and maybe the shell, that image would be just a clean slate. And then from there, you could build on top of it.
So like an image of your hard drive at the time or something?
No, an image of the OS, an image an environment, like a baseline image of just Linux. And that's like the most bottom line you can go. It's not your computer. It has a file system and it has an operating system, but it has no software installed.
Like a virtual machine?
It's very analogous to a virtual machine, except a virtual machine it's handled in a different way. It runs on top of your kernel and it runs its own kernel. So it's like two computers running on the resources of one computer, and the host computer is trying to interpret commands much slower than a container. The difference with the container is it shares. They share the same kernel, and Docker is doing the translation between your software and the OS that you're running on. And so your OS understands how to run your software because Docker is handling that translation in the middle.
Gotcha.
And so it's a lot more efficient. It's a more efficient use of resources. It runs faster, and it's smaller, less impact on the machine you run it on. VMs run similarly, and they're very analogous in most ways, but the way they operate and the way they try to run a kernel on a kernel is underperforming in some states. Okay, so of course I'm going to demo something that's not going to work. Let me make sure everything's here. I think I've only installed some of the dependencies. Thank you. So this is where we're starting from. Have you guys made React apps before using Create React App? So this will look really familiar. So Saturday, I took Create React App, and all I've done is change the title and add a calculator. Okay, so simple components, just wanted a proof of concepts, not too far away from just the baseline Create React App. So I've added some tests, I've added some functionality, and that's where we're starting from. So it's not too far to just reverse engineer if you wanted to and try to make something reusable out of this. So what I need to do, one of the things to think about when you're making a Docker file is if I download something from Git or from GitHub, it's theoretically not going to come with any dependencies. It's going to come with the source code and a few configuration files, and that's all you get. What you want to do when you create your Docker file is think of it from that exact same context. You want your Docker file to have within it defined the dependencies that you need to run. And so anything that you would need to start your app locally from GitHub, you'll probably need to define in your Docker file. But one of the common mistakes that you can take from this point is, I just ran my app. I know it works locally. All I had to do is do npm start. So my Docker file could, theoretically, I just copy everything that I have locally over and run npm start, and everything's good. So theoretically, this should work, because I know that I just ran my code and it works. And we'll talk about some pitfalls with this. So node 8, this is your image. So at the very top, everything you always do, the very first thing you always do in Docker file, is the file is define your base image. So for this particular code to run, I need node 8. I need to know how, it needs to know how to run the scripts in my package.json. And these scripts are all node commands. So these are all node packages and node commands that are necessary to run. So my base image needs to have Linux, and it needs to have node. And this node resource, so this is a repository for node products, they create all kinds of node images, and I'm using version 8. So this is like node 8 in all of its glory, that's everything you need. Okay, so I'm gonna start from here, and I'm gonna go ahead and kill this so I can demonstrate. So build, I'm going to tag it. Tagging is customary if you want to build similar images. So what they've done on node 8, they have a node image and they've tagged it with 8 to let the user know this is node version 8. Node 9 would be node 9. And then you can have all kinds of different tags to differentiate deviations from the base. So the base is node, and then you have all kinds of flavors. And so tag is like a flavor of your image. So I'm just going to call this React demo, and I'm going to tag it with full, because what I'm doing here is using the full base image of Node. So common error you'll see is if you try to do this and press enter, it's going to fail because you need to provide it the location of your Docker file. I'm running this in the directory of this where the Docker file is, so I can just run it with local and tell them to find my Docker file where I'm at right now, and this will build. So before starting this talk, I cleared all of the containers, all images on containers from my local file system. And I won't do this for every iteration of this as we go through because it'll take longer. But it has to download Node 8 every time. Or for this particular build, it's going to have to download an entire Linux distribution and all of Node 8 installed on it, as well as shell. So you can see that it's quite a hefty download just to get the prerequisites to run on, just to get the base image. And then on top of that, I'm going to move all the files from this directory into it using the copy command. I'm going to expose port 3000, because that's what React runs on, is 3000. And then I'm going to give it a command to use that when you want to run this image, it will execute that command, and it will start your code. So back to this, while that's building, again, the simplest approach is this. This is just a bigger picture of what we're just looking at. Okay, it's done. If we want to test it, you can firstly look up this. You can run Docker images. And it will show you all the images you have on your computer. I downloaded the base image of Node that's necessary to build this. And then React Demo is what I just made. And so now I have this image and this image, which is copied this inside of it, And so now I'm almost at a gig with my React demo. And if I want to try to run it, Docker run, I'm going to port forward. So I'm going to take port 3000 of the container, and I'm going to expose it to a local port so that I can see it in my browser. So I'm just going to pick 8091, and I'm exposing port 3000. So this will let me run it from my browser on localhost. And then I'm going to find the tag, and I'm going to run it in interactive mode, which is an optional tag, again, in the slides I showed earlier. And I'm just going to run this exact image I just made, which is React, demo, and then I need the tag, which is full. So between the name and the tag, you put a colon, full, and run it. And so the same printout you get when you run React locally, you will get as your Docker file runs. And then now I can go in here, and I'll be able to go to localhost 8091, and I should see the same app. So it's Dockerized, it's run, it runs, everything's fine, the app is contained. But some of the biggest problems with this very naive and basic approach is that you're copying everything you have. So just like when you send your code to Git or to GitHub, you don't copy your node modules over. You don't want to copy those dependencies over. You want to download those when you get to where you're going to just save on that upload time, to save on storage costs. You don't need to copy everything. You can define your dependencies as in a different way. It depends on your local system. So if you had stuff in your file structure that wasn't... Oh, you have a problem. So if you had files in your local directory, so this README contributes nothing to the execution of my code. There's no reason I need to move this into my Docker file and take up space within that container. And likewise, because I'm using a very large base image for a very, very simple project, it's creating a very huge container, an image of my code. So my code is very, very small, but the container is huge. Now, you do need a base image, you need Linux, you need all the necessary prerequisites to run Node and Shell and all of that, but if you can optimize that further. So I'm not gonna run these, but I'll show you these progressive improvements, right? So this is where we started. Now, I baselined this on my own computer between every one of these baselines, and we're gonna do more as we go through the talk. I cleared my state. I got rid of all my images and downloaded every image. So every single one of these Docker files ran with no prior dependencies installed on my machine. So it took 39 seconds, and this one built with 776 megabytes. That was quite different than what we just saw, which was 900 something megabytes. So it's very possible maybe the base image changed, or for some reason or another, I have a file in here I didn't have at the time I did this benchmark, but 776 is still very large and took 40 seconds to build. Now, as I said earlier, there's multiple flavors of the base image that you can use. Slim is another one. Now, with every flavor that you get, there are certain things that they add or subtract from the base image, right? So Slim will have fewer bells and whistles than the full build. So you may not have, really what it's slimming down on is Linux. It's gonna slim down on functionalities in Linux. Maybe you don't need Vim. Maybe you don't need all these nice functionalities that you would have in the full Linux distribution. So here, they give you a really slimmer distribution with no data installed, and it takes a lot less time to create because you download way fewer megabytes. And then here, same thing. Alpine is a very common, very, very lightweight distribution that you should always try to find. If you can find an Alpine build to run your Docker container, you will save the most megabytes that you can save. So really strive to find Alpines. And sometimes you run into cases where your software is complex. It uses functionalities where it has interdependencies that you didn't know about, and Alpine just won't work. There are some Java applications that I've built that Alpine is not an option because there are things in the Linux kernel I need that are not supplied in this very, very tiny image. But you can see the rest of the Docker file is exactly the same. We're still copying our entire directory over. We're still exposing the same port. We're still starting with the same thing. All we've done to optimize from there to there, bringing it down to these metrics, is change the base image. Easy blowing and fruit to optimize. So from there, we're going to talk about dependency management. You don't want to install your entire contents of your local directory into your image. So let me go ahead and check out a new branch. Okay. So from here, we're going to go ahead and start with the same base image. From now on, all I'm going to use is outline. I know it works, so there's no reason to go back to a larger image. What we're going to introduce here is Docker Ignore. Just like in gitignore, there's all kinds of files in here I don't want to put into GitHub because what's the point? I don't want to lock myself into old versions of node modules or anything like that. Just like that, you have a Docker Ignore. This does the exact same thing. When you use a greedy command such as copy plus plus or copy dot dot, when you want to copy everything from here to there, it will ignore any files, any directories that you specify in here. So just for simplicity, I'm going to ignore everything in the node modules folder and everything in the test folder. So if we open this up, I've written some tests, and there's tests on some of these calculator components. Those are ignored. I don't need those to run my software. Those are for development only. And likewise, in your package.json, you have dev dependencies here. So these are all dependencies for testing. I don't need those to run my software, so I'm going to run install with ignoring these dev dependencies, just get my actual dependencies. So what that ends up doing to your Docker file is you still copy everything over and you're letting Docker ignore prevent the stuff that you don't need from making it onto your container. And then you're going to run npm install prod only or yarn install prod. These are the same two commands between npm and yarn. And what they're going to install is only these dependencies, only these dependencies that you absolutely need to run your software. These dev dependencies are not brought into the mix. We are going to see some weird, let me show you this real fast. And then, let me back up 1 second. So here, yarn prod, and we're still exposing 3000, we're still doing the same command. So all we've changed here is we're bringing fewer things in from the local directory, and we're only installing the necessary dependencies. Now, you will note that this goes up. There are some idiosyncratic pieces of Docker that every time you run these layers of your Docker, you will get some extra overhead from Docker. I can't account for all of this. It seems pretty large, but this is still pretty small in the grand scheme of things. So we've gone up a little bit in megabytes, but we've also gone up in time, but what we've not done is locked ourselves into a bad state on the local machine. So any old modules you had that are out of version, anything that's not exactly matching up to what you define in your package.json are not brought in. So you've really eliminated a lot of risk by going with this approach. Additionally, your time to build is going up because you're reaching out from the network. You're not downloading directly from your machine, which is like the patch. You're reaching out over the network to download all of your modules. So you are incurring more time, but you're incurring better practices and safer builds. So this is a production build of React. So one thing, especially with the React code I write at work, we have a massive suite of tests. And our tests, depending on your file structure, on how you organize your app, your tests may be peppered within your component files themselves. They may be all over the place. You may have a large amount of documentation. So it may become tedious to store all of those things, all of those little things in the Docker ignore. But we know that when we build a production build of React, we're only getting the necessary dependencies. It ignores all the test extensions. You get your code minimized. You don't have a lot of white space. Variables are abstracted down to being smallest file size possible. When you run a production build, you are taking your source code and minimizing it as much as possible. In a very large project, that can have a lot of impact. In this particular project, which is, you know, three components, it's minimal. It's not even noticeable. But in a very, very large project, this can really save you a lot of bytes. So what we're doing here is same image, still copy the Docker ignore files I'm going to change from here on out. It's the same Docker ignore. And we are building a production image. And then we are adding serve, which is a module necessary to run your production image. Now, when you run your production image just with React, create React Dev as is, it runs over 5,000, so we're going to change the port we're exposing, and we're going to change our command, because we're now going to use serve to serve this up. So, I can go through this real fast, and this is the same code, so... I'm going to go ahead and get rid of everything. So, from this directory, I'm going to run this image as I just showed it. It's going to build a lot faster because we have a much smaller base image than we had last time. So, just to be safe, even though I'm running an incognito, and I'm just going to do this just in case anything catches the demo. That error I started incurring this error when I changed to a smaller Docker image. Apparently, there's something that is not present in this outline image that it expects. So even though it's an error, it doesn't impact my code still runs, everything is okay. So I'm going to ignore it for right now. I had to troubleshoot it for the purposes of this demo. But likely all I could do is add this suggested command to my Docker image at the very beginning, install that dependency that's lacking, and that would be good. But it should still perform as normal. Nothing has changed. I'm going to try a new port. So the problem with that was I'm exposing port 5,000, so I need to map from port 5,000. Can't map from 3,000. So now, same. Okay. So now we're on 8099, and everything works. So same process. Now, if we look back at the metrics, we incurred more time. We had to download an extra module. We had to do the build process, which took extra time. We incurred a little more megabytes on the serve, but now we're serving up a minimized build. So depending on how large or how your project is structured, this could save you a lot in minimizing your build. Now, I wanted to push it and see what could I do to minimize this as much as humanly possible, because I still felt like it's a very small app. What can I do to really, really cut it down? And this is where you start, and even though I was able to do this, I'm starting to break away from that concept of containerization, right? You want to containerize, you want to encapsulate your software with all of its dependencies necessary, everything there so that you can start from scratch. And what I'm doing is I'm externalizing some of the work into a script, and then I'm building from local again. So what I'm doing here, because in our world where Gene and I are at, every megabyte every time we do an iteration, every time we store, every single one of these images gets stored and we pay per byte on the cloud. So sometimes we can take a little more risk to save a lot of money overall, especially when you have a really large team with lots of developers and lots of people contributing new images. Cutting this down by 60-70% like I just did is a risk that you're willing to take if you do so smartly, even though you're not really staying true per se to the containerization principle of having everything all in one. So what this is doing is I'm clearing my node modules from local, I'm doing a production build, so I'm only bringing the dependencies I need, then I'm building on my local system, and then I'm going to build this image. And this image is going to take the build that I just did on line 3 and copy it over. That's all I'm taking, is the build directory. Minimized code, all dependencies baked in. I'm going to install serve, and then I'm going to expose and do the same stuff after that. And then afterwards, I'll clean up after myself and get rid of the build folder. So at this point, this image contains the bare minimum things necessary to run my React app. And incurred a little more time, there's more process, more background work, but I've kept it down, and for some people, and you know, in some cloud environments, this is a lot of money saved over the long term to really reduce it as much as you could. Okay, but here's some benchmarks I did. A lot of these are running on different, in all kinds of different combinations. So the first three, and this is covered in these base, this branch of base images only, all I did here was alter which images I used, and you can see how that turned out. Here, on the first two lines, we kind of compared NPM versus YARN. NPM resulted in a smaller image by 40 megabytes, but YARN per second shorter in build time, a little give and take there. When using the production build with YARN, a little bit faster, a little more, or at the same time, but a little more on your base image. No, save a little bit on the base image because I removed the test. There are new tests in that one. And then same thing here, we are optimizing as much as possible. This is the last container that has everything in it. This is kind of like fully encapsulated, everything I need, even though the container's a little bulky with the node modules that I couldn't get rid of. And then down here, the scripted attempts. This attempt, which is super fast, was not clearing out my local directory, not clearing out my node modules, and reinstalling my node modules. On the second attempt, I reinstalled all the node modules from scratch just to make sure I had exactly the dependencies I needed before I pushed them in. Those are the ones. So that's all I got, guys. If y'all have any questions, any other questions about Docker, I'll be happy to field them. Sir.
So you said that using Docker makes it more portable. So in a sense, if I were to clone this down, could I basically piggyback off your project?
So you wouldn't be able to take this the code out, as far as I know. Maybe there are methods to do that, but you could get a, so if I had software that, so if you produce something that, you know, did a particular task really well, and I didn't want to rebuild it, but I also didn't need, I just wanted it to work, and I didn't want to go pay someone to do it, and you just had it, you could make that image available to me, either through a resource online, or you could just give it to me somehow. And then, so long as I have a Docker on any OS, I can execute that. And so Docker does all the translation, so it becomes portable, but it's almost, what you really see in practice with is cloud. So this is the preferred way to move software in a minimized form, in a encapsulated, purely everything contained that you need to run it way to any system, AWS. And this is, you know, when we're always talking about not coding ourselves into corners, right? Being, you know, you're agile and all of this about not creating code that is locked into a particular system or locked into a particular language even. In this way, you can write in the language you need, get the job done, encapsulate it in Docker container, and then if you want to go from AWS to Google, you can do that. If you want to go from Google to Heroku, or is that what it's called?
Heroku.
Heroku, you can do that. Is that right?
And even like a Linux machine or something.
Anything, yeah. And so you can run it on anything, and it's just movable. It keeps your options open, and it keeps you, available to do what you need to do. You can, one of the really cool things, you can think of them like building blocks, right? So let's say this does one thing, it does it really well, it's created a particular thing, and it just so happens to be a great building block for another container. Well, I can take my React app full, just like I have Node 8 outline here, this can become the base image for something else. And so if this image is great, tested, tried, and true, great, done, but never touch it again, it's done. And then you can use it to be the base image for your next thing. And you can add a piece to that and make that an image. And now that does its thing really well. And you know that all the things you built it on top of did its thing really well. And so you can start chaining them together and add just bits and pieces. And then, I don't need it to do this anymore. So I can go grab this base image and build on top of it and take, build it a different path. And so it's really expansible in that way, and it just leaves so many options on the table for you to adapt and move and be, agile.
Sorry, a couple questions.
Sure.
about? Is that like just called Docker?
It's just Docker syntax. If you, one thing I didn't cover that you'll see a lot of for optimization is Docker work directory, right? One of the commands that, and if you go to the docs, you'll see it, but you can get all kinds of values. So if we get, I'm trying to find a more complicated Docker file example here. You can set environment variables in your Docker container, and there's all kinds of these things. So work directory is kind of like you can establish a root file in your Docker container, and just like when you, so kind of like how as you copy things over, Docker ignores working in the background to exclude certain files from coming in. Work directory early on will establish a root, and any command you do to move things into your Docker container will move them to that root folder. Okay. So it kind of like establishes the beginning of your file structure, your file system internally. And there's all kinds of commands, all kinds of optimization you can have, but this syntax is specific to Docker.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, and sorry, another question.
So Linux is baked in to just about every image. I don't think that they make images in anything other than Linux because it's not open source and it's not, to build on Windows would be copyright. No one's going to do that. Microsoft's not going to let that happen. So I think, as far as I know, everything is Linux.
Okay.
Some flavor of Linux.
Okay. And then, sorry,
I'm
not hogging. Okay, good.
So the we can take this out and just be npm install, right?
Okay.
And you can do, I think it's only equals production.
It has the names of them.
Right, so it installs them separately or something.
Yeah, it's the same when you push to Heroku, and it's not, you're not sending all your node modules folder with it when you're saying git push Heroku master or anything like that. It goes to Heroku, and then you can watch while it builds.
Right,
it does all this
right.
as well.
And really, so copy dot dot is just the really lazy, greedy way to do it all at once in one line. But really what you could do here is say, like what I did earlier, I could do copy public to public. So put public in a directory called public, and then copy source into source. Great. So now all I've copied into this container are my two folders that contain my code, right? Node modules is not something I want. README isn't something I want. Yarn mock I kind of want. But the third thing, but this the most important part to make all of this work is you need your package.json. So when you move your package.json over, then now npm install from the root directory will go into your package, will read your package.json and install your dependencies. So captured in that dot dot was your package.json, which is what these commands running is.
Okay, and then one more.
Sure.
So it looks like you're hard coding your port, like you have exposed 5000.
Yes.
But when you deploy this, right, like how's it, like, it seems like you would want to hard code your port.
Well, you need to define what port your container runs on. I'm not an expert at this part because I never dive into how this works because I never need to use it this way. But if you don't specify a port, if you don't forward your port and you just run your image, you're going to be running inside Docker on your machine, which is software running on your machine.
Right. But I know locally you want to know your port.
Yes.
You hard code it. But I mean, won't you deploy this entire thing when you deploy it?
Yes.
How does it, I guess when we were creating servers and stuff, we would say, hey, use whatever port is specified, or use 3000, right?
Okay.
Or 5000, whatever. But this one, it doesn't say or, it just says 5000. This is the hard-coded port number.
Sure. So at least and I can speak to Google Cloud, I can't speak to other cloud platforms because I haven't used them to the same extent, but in GCP, when you deploy a container and you put a load balancer on top of that, load balancer.
Okay, yeah.
So when you deploy a container, you know because you defined in your container which port is exposed.
Right.
And you can expose probably multiple ports if you made a really complex thing and you had lots of different ports that are serving up data. But when you configure this in the cloud, when you deploy it, you will specify which port to run in your deployment. So,
this is not what you're going to deploy.
Yeah, you don't deploy this file. You deploy the artifact that it creates.
I get it. Okay.
You deploy the artifact that it creates, and then that has this port exposed because you defined it.
Right.
And then when it runs in the machine that it runs in Docker, it will do this port forwarding that we're talking about and make it available while you won't really do this. It's going to expose 5,000 on the machine that it runs on. And you will configure it to do the necessary thing. So we will remap that port 5,000 to like port 8, which is the default HTTP port. So that way you don't have to specify. Like when you go to google.com, you don't specify if you've got Google's address, their IP address, you can go to that IP address directly.
Right.
The default port is 80. Right. So in these types of situations, we would say map 5000 to 80 from this container, and that is going to be the port that our users will interface with.
Maybe, okay, so this thing, when we were deploying it to Heroku always,
mm-hmm.
and maybe, are you saying Heroku does it for us, and so we would have to do it ourselves?
Potentially, very, very likely so, because, or you will always build your images in the same way because you know what Heroku can understand. So if Heroku says, always, specify your port, except when it's port 3000, because we'll always try 3000 if you don't specify.
Yeah, we just set a variable, and then Heroku knows that variable.
So. Sure. Okay. And so that is probably the situation here, where if you always expose 3000 and you deploy to Heroku without ever configuring anything in Heroku, it's defaulting. That's Heroku's default value.
Well,
that's how I would, that would be my first hypothesis.
Well, no, that's not what happens. What happens is we specify port 3000 on our local machines, but when we deploy it, we don't barcode 3000, we say port, some variable or 3000. So if that variable is not available, then it'll use
it. It always fall back.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But Heroku uses that variable as their, to
and stuff is obscured for us because we get into our URL.
Exactly, right. I know that a lot of companies use this instead of Heroku, and I didn't really understand what it was the difference, but
I would imagine if I did some research that Heroku is using Docker on the back end, and they're just taking care of all the difficult configuration stuff.
Right.
And you can do that in Google, I think. So Google Cloud Platform has Kubernetes, which is the most configurable thing I've ever used. And you can just drown in configuration. But App Engine for Google is similar to Heroku. There's a lot of stuff done for you. And you just supply with a container, and it'll run your container, and it'll do its best effort to just make it work. And there's kind of abstraction layers you don't get to mess with. You don't have to deal with it. It makes it easy for the user. It makes it easy for people to get started. But when you get down into some of the configuration, it can become overwhelming, especially if it's configuration challenging from the very beginning with so many variables.
So those home events and workers,
sure. So actually, I have my own Kubernetes, and let's see. Actually, I took down my cluster today, but how unfortunate. This would be a question I came up. So, in Cloud Platform, let's use. So in Kubernetes, if I had one, because I think I took it down, if I had a cluster would be running here. The cluster is built of many virtual machines, and the virtual machines are actually what are running Docker, and Docker is what's running my containers. But in Google Cloud Platform, what you do is you have a container registry down here that is hosting all of your images. So if I go in here and look at my images, you can see all the different images that I've built before, and each of these is a directory of images. So if I go to this one, we can see all the different versions of this I've tried to deploy in the past as I've incrementally changed, added code, and tried different things. And so these containers are running. Tags are very important because there's all kinds of customization with tags, and say always run the tag that has the greatest number. So if I'm running, if I have tags version 1 through 8, it will always try to run version 8, assuming that I'm tagging with that type of thing. So the way Google Cloud works is that you will give it an image, you will tell it, you will define a deployment and say, here's my image. I want you to run 6 instances of this image. I want you to expose it on port 80. I want you to load balance it in this way. I want you to have this scheduling service and these health checkpoints and all this configuration. And then it will spit out to you an IP address that you can use. And if you want to configure that with DNS and you want to give it a web address and all that stuff, you can go for it. But this is much lower level than Heroku or App Engine or other options that kind of do a lot of that for you to make it easier to get going, because nothing more frustrating than knowing that you're doing this part right and then nothing works and you don't know where to go. So it's a little more configuration heavy, but you deploy all your images here, and this is where megabytes matter, right? So if all of these were 200 megabytes, it can increase all of this by, you know, threefold. And so the cost of them storing this for me goes up because they charge me monthly to use their services. So this is where you can accumulate a lot of storage costs and everything. But you can go in here and erase the images you want and just have none of that. That's how Google handles it. You store your images here, and I think, I'm pretty sure, I don't use necessarily App Engine and all of that, but I think Cloud Container Registry is available through all of their different APIs, all their different services. So all your images live here, and you can deploy it to this service, that service, this service, however way you want to, whichever flavor of put myself on the internet you want to use. But that's how it works.
Is load balancer kind of like it means like AWS Beanstalk or something that it just kind of it detects and it expands?
I picked the worst day to do all this stuff. So in my cluster, I would have workloads, and workloads would be our running software. This is my source code. This is the meat of everything, right? This is the software that I want to run. You can define any number of services to go on top of that. Load balancer is a type of service. Other services would be schedulers or port forwarding or any type of, not port forwarding, I'm thinking of something else, but services are different little chunks of software that perform different actions on top of your software. So they're little processes that are specific to Kubernetes that help provide different features in the platform. So there's lots of services that will, you can schedule, you know, restarting your pod so that they're never in a bad state, or you can put a load balancer on top of it, which is a service which will expose the port that you define to an IP address, and that IP address will then be mapped to a global IP address, or readily accessible over the web. So then you can then use that in your APIs and give that to people. Load balancer is really what's taking it off of Google's closed network and making it publicly available. That's the purpose of the load balancer.
I have a question, just really generally.
Yeah.
In class, we learned that DevOps is a field, mm-hmm.
Yes.
Right? So is this DevOps?
Is this
regular development with a DevOps flavor?
So when I started HomeDepot, I was on the DevOps team.
Okay.
My team.
All right.
So we looked at lots of different options. We decided with Kubernetes. And getting all of the backend stuff, like all of everybody's code working in tandem, becoming developing processes for testing, developing processes for deployments, all of that, for the most part, is part of this. So everyone needs to deploy their code in the same way. And the way you deploy code to Kubernetes is X, Y, and Z. You have to make that the process, and then you enforce that process from the DevOps perspective. And here, you can just get caught up forever, like doing security and like network security and network mapping and all of this, the very nuanced stuff about firewall rules and different types of firewall ranges that you can apply to different types of code and all of that. So that is definitely the DevOps side of things. All of this, this white screen is DevOps. The black screen is developer. And then you can mix and match and cross over as much as you want. You can really, you can, like, I really like this stuff, and I really find enjoyment out of learning this stuff and getting into the weeds a little bit. I like this more, but I really like this. And so I'm cool with trying it out and knowing about it to the extent that I can know about it. But we, I mean, we have people that are doing this for 20 years, that are architects, and this is their bread and butter. This is what they, with a lifetime of experiences of all different kinds of platforms, all different types of bad things to do and great things to do, and lots of knowledge and accumulation of experience, they know how to do this stuff from a really high level, and then as you get more familiar with the tool, you can know how to execute it at a low level. But I know as much as I need to be effective, but not definitely not all of it. You could spend a whole career just learning how to do this stuff. DevOps is, like you said, a whole other field. Just like security.
I've been exposed to related things about when I first heard about it, I couldn't imagine what it was. Mm-hmm. But it's like you said, like, how do we put ourselves on the internet?
Yeah.
Right? So, and then that, in this case, that's what that looks like.
Yeah, so this is it. This is definitely it. And I wish I had one running so you could see different things spinning here, but they charged me by the hour, so I turned it off this morning. I've been so busy. I mean, it's not a lot for an hour, but I've been so busy at work that I haven't really been paying attention to it, so it's just been like, change. So I turned it off this morning to just take a break.
Is it like worth the year free or something?
You get $300 for free until you spend it all. So if you're like me and you've been working with it, you know exactly stuff to do. You don't play with it so much. So I just jump right in and I just find $300 really fast. So you get $300, but then after that they ask you, do you want to continue using Google? You're like, oh man.